How would you like to do something difficult and terribly dangerous?
You said you wouldn't hurt me.
Did I? I must have had my fingers crossed.
Where are you right now? On the train? Comfortable in bed? In your lounge? Picture your living space, perhaps a sofa, a fireplace, a coffee table, somewhere you're very familiar with. Now, do you believe you could navigate this environment with your eyes shut? Initially, maybe you could hazard a good guess from memory, but where exactly is the edge of that coffee table? Where is the vase of flowers? Where is the doorway out? Imagine if this is your life all of the time. Now, imagine you're there on your own, with a ruthless psychopath who would gladly see you dead. Director Terence Young was no stranger to high-octane thrills, as any Bond fanatic will validate. His run of gung-ho's Sunday matinee-style action movies in the 50s culminating in Dr. No, From Russia with Love and Thunderball respectively by 1965. Proving he could keep right on trend, in 1967 he took on not only much darker thrills but the work that Stephen King cites as his personal most terrifying film ever. Wait Until Dark was originally a Broadway play in 1966, incredibly starring Lee Remick and Robert Duvall. But Young and producer Mel Ferrer saw the huge potential in turning playwright Frederick Knott's work into a screenplay, having had major success with Dial M for Murder throughout the 1950s. And so casting begins. George C. Scott and Robert Redford were early considerations for the male leads, while for the pivotal role of Susie Hendricks, Julie Andrews was actually contemplated here. I could see that working because Susie Hendricks needed an initial air of utterly sweet vulnerability. But eventually they made the equally bold but inspired choice of Audrey Hepburn, darling of great romantic comedies like Roman Holiday and, of course, Breakfast at Tiffany's, while Richard Crenna and Alan Arkin became the sinister antagonists. The stage, as it were, was set. A doll concealing an illicit substance arrives in New York from Montreal, smuggled through customs by trafficker Lisa. Upon arrival, however, Lisa is aware that she's being watched, and so, in haste, palms the dubious toy off onto a fellow passenger before being manhandled away by the mystery observant. The unwitting passenger here is professional photographer Sam Hendricks. Sam and his wife Susie reside in a basement apartment in the city. Enter Mike and Carlino. Something of a con artist, Mike believes they've been invited there by Lisa and it to be her apartment. As soon as they realise this is a mistake, however, they move to leave, but... This is Harry Rote, the sinister guy from the airport. Here, Rote coerces the two into aiding him in finding the doll. They're encouraged to hand over any concealed weapons. Not Rote. He has what he refers to as Geraldine. He's keeping her as insurance. They locate the doll, receive a substantial payoff. Nobody gets exposed. It's simple. Or so it seems.
What are you doing, Mr. Rote?
Mike wonders if Rote has checked the locked closet in the bedroom yet.
I'd like the key.
But when he pushes him too hard...
Oh, my fat man, over there, now both of you through the door backwards.
They outwit Rote and demand the key, but Mike isn't prepared for what he finds. That's it. They're out. However...
Haven't you forgotten something?
We just earned the money.
I mean fingerprints.
He's got them over a barrel. And now, the screw turns tighter.
Sam?
Sam?
This is Susie Hendricks. Susie lost her sight in a car accident some months ago.
Gloria? I just thought I'd call to tell you I was the best in blind school today.
The intruders listen on in silence. She arranges to meet Sam for a coffee and enters the bedroom to get a scarf. And then leaves again. But not before.
Gloria, I know you're there.
They get back to work. A vulnerable blind woman on her own. Just keep Sam out of the way and this should be simple, shouldn't it? And so a treacherous and elaborate dance begins, with Susie at the mercy of three individuals, one of whom will stop at nothing to get what he came for. But Susie isn't completely alone. Gloria, the young girl from upstairs, is not without her troubles. Parental mostly, she's stubborn, headstrong, and at times downright aggressive. The three are aware of Gloria. She should pose no problem. So as Sam leaves for a fake work trip arranged by Rote, they send Mike in for the softly, softly approach on Susie. His timing, coincidentally, is perfect. She's detected smoke but has no way of knowing where it's coming from.
Gloria! Somebody!
She makes it to the phone.
Fire department, please, can you... There's something burning and I'm blind and I can't locate it. Oh, wait, I think somebody's here. Come in!
Mrs. Hendricks, are you all right?
Mike deals with it. It was a smouldering ashtray on the...
What is this, safe?
He introduces himself as an old friend of Sam's.
My name's Mike Tallman. I used to know Sam.
Sam, he says, saved his life in the Marines.
The 3rd Battalion.
Charlie Company.
Charlie Company, right.
He deceives her further, noticing the photography on the walls.
Hey, here's one of me. I sure have put on a few pounds since those days.
This is Gloria. Susie invites her in, but she looks suspicious and leaves without saying a word. But as Mike departs, she's still there. She's come for the grocery list, but when Susie asks for her help in defrosting the freezer, Susie insists on doing it Sam's way. Gloria wants to do it the easy way, and it seems Gloria is used to getting her own way. Gloria apologises. They share a moment here. Susie wishes she could do more for herself. Gloria wishes she was more beautiful. Like Susie.
Did we break anything?
Oh no, I only threw unbreakables.
Then as she leaves, a strange guy shows up.
I should very much like to speak with Mr. Sam Hunt, little girl.
Susie! Susie!
What is it?
I should like to see Mr. Sam Hunt.
He rants on about seemingly Sam and another woman, insists he's found the proof, and exits, leaving Susie no explanation. He passes Mike on the way out. She is relieved to see him. He tells Susie he'll call the police in case anything was taken. But it's not the police.
099.
Carlino arrives as the police, and the two men feign an interaction while sending signals outside to Rote. They also busy themselves, removing any trace of fingerprints. Now they tighten the screws even further on Susie, fake cop Carlino suggesting her husband may have something to do with the body of a woman found in the park and the whereabouts of a doll. The seed is planted. But Susie isn't stupid. She noticed the meticulous dusting. And another random visitor? He says he's the son of the agitated stranger from earlier, but this time Susie notices something.
What is it, Susie?
His father isn't crazy, he states, just that for his son's sake, he believes Sam and his own wife are having an affair. Sam had gifted his wife a doll while on vacation, and more, she didn't come home last night. Could Sam be cheating on her? And worse, is he the one who killed the woman in the park? This guy's wife? So, while Mike convinces Susie the police are parked outside watching, they turn the apartment upside down to find the doll. It's not there. It's now, still trusting Mike, Susie reveals something that didn't quite add up to her. The young man seemed to be wearing the exact same shoes as his erratic father. She recognised the distinct squeak and something else.
Then why has everybody been playing around with the blinds?
Susie's putting the puzzle together piece by piece, and the final picture could be deadly for her. Mike is becoming jittery.
If we want to help Sam, we've got to find that doll before they do.
But it isn't here! It isn't here!
It must be!
He insists it must be in the safe, but she insists it isn't. It doesn't belong to them and they don't have the key. He says he has to leave to catch a flight. In reality, he's sending Carlino in to increase the pressure. But in the meantime, Gloria lets herself in. And she has the doll. In fact, she'd had it all along. Susie has Gloria check out the police car outside. There isn't one, but someone's coming. Carlino peers through the window while Gloria keeps Susie informed. However, just as he moves away, they need to hide it, and quickly. Then, they hatch a plan.
How would you like to do something difficult and terribly dangerous?
I'd love it.
Gloria is to watch the phone booth outside and give two rings to Susie if there's any activity. If Susie needs her, she is to knock on the pipes in the corner. But before she can leave, Carlino arrives.
I'll be right with you, Sergeant.
Susie distracts him with the tail of a broken window, while Gloria makes her escape. Now, Carlino goes full bad cop on Susie.
You've been looking for something, I see.
I couldn't find the garbage bags.
No. Now, I wonder where that doll can be. In that, big black safe, maybe?
There is no doll, and my husband never knew Mrs. Rose.
He did, as a matter of fact, know her.
She pretends to call the precinct. Her plan works. He abruptly insists on making the call himself. Of course he does.
Hello?
Because Carlino isn't calling the station. Gloria, though, has seen the activity in the phone booth and makes her call.
Be right back with a search warrant.
Must be the wrong number.
She calls Mike, trustingly, to inform him she's found the doll.
Hello? Great.
Mike's number, of course, is also the phone outside.
Oh, Mike. Everything's going to be all right now, isn't it?
Of course. Everything's going to be fine now, isn't it? Isn't it? She fumbles to call the police, but...
Operator, the police emergency!
Susie, it's me, Mike.
You must have the wrong number.
While she attempts to stall him, Carlino and Harry Rote watch on from the doorway. Susie thinks fast and grabs her keys.
Where are you going?
To Sam's studio, that's where it is.
She's stumbling now.
Had to do an errand for Sam, and she saw 78 West 8th Street. It's in the left-hand drawer, the doll.
She manages to convince Mike to go to the studio instead, and then bangs on the pipes for Gloria. The girls revise their strategy. Gloria is to slide past Carlino and head for the bus station to await Sam's return.
Buzz off, kid.
Well.
Susie is to call the police, but the phone line is dead, severed by rote. Now, Susie can't call for help. She can't get out of the door. And Gloria is gone. But then, she has an idea. A light bulb moment, you could say. A moment too soon, as
Susie, it's me, Mike.
There was no doll at the studio.
There wasn't even a desk.
But Susie is defiant. She stands her ground. He's not getting the doll.
Mrs. Hendricks,
Susie, we're not strangers.
It's obvious now. Sam didn't kill Lisa.
You give me that doll, and you give it to me fast! Give it to me!
But then neither did Mike.
Mr. Rhodes.
He softens somewhat, seemingly admiring her tenacity.
It said he wants to do evil things.
You don't have to worry about Rhodes.
Mike and Carlino flipped a coin on who should take Rhodes down. Carlino won. So that's it then. Susie is safe. Sam will be home soon with Gloria. Mike bids his goodbye.
A good strong lady. Susie Hendricks.
World's champion blind lady.
Except, I promised you extreme terror, didn't I? And now it begins.
I want you to know it.
What is it?
It's that squeaking footstep. It's rote. As was this. As was this.
What are you doing, Mr. Rhodes?
Gasoline!
Well, sir.
What are you going to do with that gasoline?
No, you just guess.
Obvious is delighting in her fear and vulnerability, above just wanting the doll. Offering her a seat, he elaborates on taking out Mike and Carlino before they could get to him, and sending Sam on a wild goose chase just to keep him out of the picture. But this is just the start of his psychological torture.
Are you going to give me that doll, Susie? I don't believe you, Susie.
I can't, I don't have it anymore.
Just when I hear.
He ordered. orders her to stand.
I said, stand up.
This could be it for her. But never underestimate Susie Hendricks.
Now, go into the bedroom.
Mr. Rowe.
Hmm?
You looking at me?
Yes, sir. Don't touch that!
Susie has his knife.
And I've got the matches, Mrs. Hendricks.
But Susie has his gasoline.
No, stop!
Try lighting a match now, Mr. Rowe. Throw your matches over to me. Go on, don't move. I still have your knife. Pick up the cane. And tap on the floor right where you are so I know where you are. Keep tapping. Keep tapping. Tap. Keep tapping. Tap. Tap.
In the darkness, she makes her way up the steps and to the door. But then...
Well, Susie... It's all over. Drop the knife.
Oh.
And the matches. Down we go.
You can have the... No! I'll give it to you if you'll just go.
Please. May I give you the doll?
Please, may I give you the doll?
You may. Catchy tune. Well, Susie? Now I want you in the bedroom.
You said you wouldn't hurt me.
I must have had my fingers crossed.
The absolute genius of Wait Until Dark lies in director Terence Young's masterful command over a constantly twisting and changing plot, much of which I couldn't include here as this particular deep dive would be longer than the film itself. There's some bold subject matter here, particularly for the late 60s, hard narcotics, claustrophobic confinement and crippling psychological torture. It's one brave piece of cinema. A couple of fine anecdotes before I round up. Over the decades, movie houses have tried various gimmicks to engage their audiences. In 1974, for example, Universal Studios used Sensoround, a sound process to rumble seats during the screenings of Earthquake. Then, in 1981, director John Waters cheekily presented the satirical comedy Polyester, complete with Odorama, where the audience were invited to, cautiously, scratch and sniff a numbered card throughout the movie, corresponding with the scenes on screen. Some pleasant and some not so much. For Wait Until Dark, though, they were more subtle and devious to immerse its audience in the terror. As the film neared its climax, one by one the house lights were dimmed to their legal limit. Then, as Susie smashes that final bulb, they black them out completely. Essentially, it would be you, Susie, and sadistic psychopath Rhodes trapped in the apartment. In complete darkness. And finally, those who've seen Wait Until Dark must be saying to themselves, but how could he not mention that moment? Of course not. No spoilers on this channel. Let them experience the sheer joy and horror of it themselves. In the dark. In silence. But I will leave you with this about that moment from Alan Arkin, Mr. Rote himself.
And I hear this scream from like 1,000 people, and it scared the hell out of me. I said, God, what's that? And he said, it's you.